वेलकम बैक टू दी कोर्स टाइटल्ड क्वालिटेटिव रिसर्च मेथड्स. माय नेम इज़ आराधना मलिक एंड आई एम हेल्पिंग यू विद दिस कोर्स. एंड वी हैव बीन डिस्कसिंग द डिफरेंट पैराडाइम्स ऑफ क्वालिटेटिव इंक्वायरी. वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सम बिट ऑफ कंस्ट्रक्टिविज्म, वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इंटरप्रेटिविज्म. वी विल इन दिस लेक्चर वी विल रैप अप द डिस्कशन रिगार्डिंग इंटरप्रेटिविज्म एंड कंस्ट्रक्टिविज्म एज पैराडाइम्स ऑफ क्वालिटेटिव इंक्वायरी. वी विल डिस्कस द क्रिटिक्स to constructivism and interpretivism, the criticisms that have come up regarding interpretivism and constructivism. So that is what we will talk about now. The first criticism is the problem of criteria. How do we decide what needs to be interpreted and how? And do we, so in the absence of some set of criteria, such accounts are subject to the charges of solipsism. Solipsism means the interpretation from the perspective of one inquirer. Solipsism and relativism, all accounts are equally good or bad, worthy or unworthy, true or false, and so on. So in the absence of some set of criteria, we can say everybody's interpretation is all right, everybody's interpretation is acceptable. One researcher feels something in a certain way and another researcher feels something different about the same phenomenon, and both are okay. So you know, there's a problem of criteria. How do we decide which research is more robust? How do we decide which process of creation of knowledge, which process of inquiry is more accurate than the other? What are the criteria that are being used to find out more about the object of inquiry? The resolution of this problem of criteria are, the first is methodology. The notion of an appeal to procedural criteria as grounds for judging the goodness of interpretations is strong. So as long as we use some widely accepted method for getting the data from what we are studying, for obtaining the inputs from the object of inquiry, our arguments regarding the interpretation can be strong. And as long as we use some set methods for interpretation, the criteria can vary from researcher to researcher. As long as the study of methods is thorough and the selection of the method used to get the data is based on some logic, the problem of criteria can be addressed. Arguments for subtle realism. The intuition is that the truth, worth or value of a claim, theory, interpretation, construction and so forth is ultimately determined by something beyond the claim, theory, interpretations and construction. There can be multiple non-contradictory descriptive and explanatory claims about any phenomenon without denying that if those interpretations are accurate, they must correspond in relevant aspects to the phenomena described. So, which means that if we are describing a phenomenon, we are using a standard method for describing, for getting the information. Methods don't describe phenomena. It is the analysis and the subsequent interpretation of the analyzed information that helps us describe phenomena. So, when we, you know, we appeal to subtle realism, that as long as the descriptions match the reality, as long as the value of a claim, as long as the applicability of the theory is determined by something beyond the claim or is connected to what is real, what is believable, and as long as it is in some way consistent with the interpretations of others who have studied the same phenomenon, as long as it is not contradicting the interpretations of others who have studied the same phenomenon from different perspectives based on different criteria, as long as the contradictions do not occur or serious contradictions are not there and everything explains reality in one way or another, we can make a case to address this problem of criteria for studying the observed. Then, the third way in which this is addressed is to acknowledge that a human inquirer is permanently engaged in a discourse with his or her own object, and to give up the worry about a separation of mind and world and focus instead on intentional, meaningful behavior that is by definition historically, socially and culturally relative. So, we accept that the inquirer is constantly in conversation, the inquirer is constantly interacting with what is being observed. And it is this interaction that is giving a rich, unique flavor to the interpretation. And we accept this and we bring it out in the way we describe the phenomenon. So, you know, we don't negate it, we don't talk about complete separation of the observed from the observer. We discuss the relationship and we also describe the impact this relationship can have on the meaning that is described or that is shared or the meaning that is created. As long as we acknowledge that this relationship is having some impact on the meaning that is created, the problem of the criteria not being addressed is taken care of. The second is the problem of descriptivism, and again I'm sorry for the large amount of text. I think it's very important for you to see how the stalwarts in this field have discussed these issues. So the problem of descriptivism talks about the fact that interpretive accounts lack any critical interest or the ability to critique the very accounts they produce. So that is the problem, and they say that there is no critical interest, it's all about describing. The individual as a social scientist operates with the attitude of the disinterested observer and abides by the rule for evidence and objectivity within the scientific community, whereas the individual as citizen legitimately has a practical, pragmatic, interested attitude. The individual turned social scientist brackets out that attitude and adopts the posture of objective, disinterested, empirical theorist who is removed from the object of inquiry, who is trying to study the object of inquiry from a disinterested, supposedly objective perspective. So, critics hold that it is precisely because of this distancing of oneself as inquirer that interpretivists cannot engage in an explicitly critical evaluation of the social reality they seek to portray. Critics say that you are trying to describe things, you are also trying to describe the relationship you have with the observed, you are also engaging with the observed. So, will that not change the natural behavior of the observed? And that is one big critique of this whole approach to interpretivism and constructivism, that how can you describe something that you are involved with? How can you describe something that you have a relationship with? How can you you need to distance yourself from the inquired, and if you distance yourself then you can't describe the relationship, but if you are connected then the relationship changes because of the connection. So what do you do? So that is one criticism that is there. So that is again addressed by the fact, and I haven't put the resolution here, but this is addressed by putting out by this the last point in the previous issue, which is to acknowledge that the human inquirer is permanently engaged. So, we are discussing, when we describe something, then we lay it out, and what our engagement with the or our engagement as social scientists, as qualitative researchers with the object of study becomes a part of the description that we are putting forth as the new knowledge that has been created, and that in turn adds to the body of knowledge that already exists. ओके सो अगेन यू नो दैट इज द अदर एस्पेक्ट एंड द थर्ड क्रिटिसिज्म इज इफ इंडिविजुअल्स कंस्ट्रक्ट देयर ओन नॉलेज हाउ कैन ग्रुप्स ऑफ पीपल अपियर टू शेयर कॉमन नॉलेज एंड वी गो बैक टू दिस होल आइडिया ऑफ सोलिप्सिज्म सो इट्स knowledge that you create, knowledge that I create, knowledge that somebody else creates, knowledge, you know, so knowledge is created in pockets, so how do we share it? The resolution is that, you know, how do we address this issue, how do we address this criticism? We address it by saying that construction is a process in which knowledge is both built and continually tested. So reflexivity is a response. Knowledge is not only created, knowledge is also being tested and the interpretation, the creation of knowledge is continually being tested and for its fit into the context from which it was created. Individuals are not free to construct any knowledge. Their knowledge must be viable. It must work. So this is one of the ways in which you know this is addressed. Knowledge is not just created in isolation. Knowledge is just not created in thin air. It is created as part of a social structure and it has to be constantly tested by virtue of its relation with that social fabric, the contextual, not the social fabric, but the contextual fabric that it has come out of. And it has to be, and it is modified, it is engaged with what has been studied, and it becomes a part of that contextual. It eventually becomes a part of that contextual fabric, and that is when we say that this knowledge is really the verify, or this is true knowledge. Only when the line between what was old and what is new is diminished, it becomes very blurred, and you don't know where the old knowledge has ended and the new knowledge has begun. That is when we say that it has really, that new knowledge has really been created. So it adds to the context from which it was created, and that is one way of resolving this problem. This lecture was very short, and but I wanted this to be a separate lecture so that the students can grasp whatever had been done earlier. I would suggest that you listen to this lecture after listening to the previous lectures in one go. So you listen to the previous lectures, but then when you're listening to this, please revisit the lectures on interpretivism and constructivism that were put up before this lecture, and then you listen to this lecture, and that will sort of form a complete whole about the paradigms from which we paradigms used for qualitative inquiry. So that is all we have time for. Thank you very much for listening. We will continue with some more inputs on qualitative inquiry in the next lecture.